Now, from the POTUS studios in Washington, D.C., this is The Press Pool with Julie Mason.
Thank you so much for being with me, and what a delight to welcome back into the studio his first appearance of 2019, Steve Chaggaris. He's a veteran political reporter. You can find him on Twitter at Steve Chaggaris and his blog, campaign2020focus.com. Shaggy!
Happy New Year.
Very happy New Year indeed.
Can I ask you a question about that?
Yeah, sure.
What's the expiration date for wishing somebody a Happy New Year? I have a friend whose pet peeve is saying Happy New Year too far past New Year's Day.
Really?
Yes.
I think it's good like through January.
The whole month?
Yeah.
Oh, that's pretty liberal.
Yeah.
Yeah. My friend literally like January 4th cut it off. And I do have to say, I never really thought about it that much. Although over the weekend I was watching football and Pizza Hut had an ad that offered some sort of deal till January 8th. And the music in the background was Auld Lang Syne. And I'm like, this is a little weird for, is it still the holiday season? I guess it sort of is. You can say Happy New Year on January 6th.
Yeah. 7th. Yeah, sure. Why not?
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
I mean, if we've learned anything from the Trump administration, rules don't matter.
Rules are
like,
meant to be broken.
Write your own rules, right?
We just said that with
yeah.
that.
Yeah, exactly.
No
yeah.
more rules.
And plus, it's goodwill, right? Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Goodwill.
Yes.
Question here from a listener. Didn't Joe Biden have some kind of plagiarism scandal back in the 80s? Think that will come back and haunt his 2020 presidential bid?
Well, he sure did. And, you know, it was brought up again when he ran in 07 and 08. And, you know, it'll be brought up again. But is it, you know, look, there are a lot of other things for people to nail Joe Biden on between his career in the Senate and things that he said when he was on the trail
not really new ground though.
Not really,
you know,
new ground.
It's like sort of pre-chewed.
Also, in terms of controversies, like with what we've seen in the last couple of years, is really a plagiarism thing from 1987 gonna really derail a candidacy at this point?
Yeah, probably not.
I think Democrats would argue they've had trouble derailing the president with bigger things.
David Brody was on earlier, and he was making a strong point about Biden that he can't be defined by President Trump the way, for example, Elizabeth Warren can.
Well, right. There's no nickname yet, right? There's no simple way to sort of nail Biden. I think that's one way to look at why Biden might be a decent matchup against Trump. Here's the other thing.
Wait, but isn't that like sort of a sort of sad fact that like what makes Biden viable is Trump can't give him a mean nickname that sticks.
Well, that's not the only thing that makes him viable, but seriously, like this is a guy, whoever is the nominee, male or female, is going to be incessantly insulted and made fun of and by Trump on Twitter and on the campaign on the campaign trail every single day, multiple times a day.
Yes.
Now, the Pocahontas thing is a thing that has gone back a few years with Trump and Elizabeth Warren, and his supporters are using it as a rallying cry, and it speaks to an issue that she still is having trouble running away from, right? And so that is going to make sure that issue continues to come up repeatedly. It's not just the nickname. It's not just the fact he's making fun of her. There's an underlying issue about her biography that she's going to have to continually answer for. She was asked a couple of times about it during her trip in Iowa this weekend. She tried to move past it, but it's not going away.
She tried. It's not going away.
Well, now you have to actually start losing your voice.
It's not going away.
She had a bit of a cold or something. I do have to say, though, her announcement on New Year's Eve and her trip to Iowa, I'm not that critical of it. I think it's actually good for the process with this idea of the fact that there may be two dozen Democrats running for president. I think that this may start to winnow the field a little bit earlier than not she specifically, but the fact that big names are going to now feel the pressure to start to make a decision. That's why you have Joe Biden now saying, okay, by the end of the month, I'm going to get in. Kamala Harris, Cory Booker.
Kamala.
Is it Kamala?
Kamala.
I thought it was Kamala like
no,
Pamela.
Like Pamela, no. Common
really?
Mistake. Kamala.
Kamala.
I forget how we know that, but we know that.
Okay.
Someone was, I think it was a California political reporter who was like schooling me on that.
Ah, well, so I've been saying it wrong all these years.
I had been saying it wrong for years.
At least I haven't been saying Kamala, which some people
Kamala,
say.
Yeah. Kamala.
Kamala Harris. Kamala. Like Pamela.
Like comma chameleon.
Yeah. Anyway, the point I was making was I think we're going to start seeing a lot of the bigger names who may be on the fence either make a decision to get angered out earlier. And perhaps the smaller names who may realize...
Small names?
Well, people
who... small name?
People who don't... Okay. So, people who don't have the national... name recognition that some of these others do may say, hey, well, how am I going to break through when Joe Biden and Kamala Harris and Cory Booker and Michael Bloomberg and Elizabeth Warren are in this race? I mean, we remember what happened in 2016 with the Republicans. There were, what, 16 or 17 candidates? Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, what, we talked about six or seven of them.
Right.
Right? The rest of them were just sort of there for
Gilmore.
Jim Gilmore. Like,
we both came up with Gilmore, yes.
Well, but I say that, and we say that as we would sort of refer to Terry McAuliffe, perhaps, another former governor of Virginia who is mulling a bit on the Democratic side.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah, McAuliffe's got a little bit of bigger name recognition, a larger name recognition, but seriously, like, what is he going to...
T-Mac.
As a one-term governor of Virginia.
And a Clinton bagman for decades.
And a Syracuse accent blended with a weird Southern thing that he tried to bring into it when he became governor
really?
Of Virginia. Yes, it's very weird to listen to him.
But he's got a good spot right in the middle, centrist lane.
Yeah, but there's a lot of, I mean, you could argue that, you know, Biden may take some of that. You can argue that Cory Booker may be in on that. And, you know, I guess, sure, there's a lane, but it's like multiple people for every lane, right? And everybody's also presuming that these lanes are sort of the guardrails are made out of concrete when there are really no guardrails at all.
Not at all.
You know, and there's all this talk about Biden. Young people would not vote for Biden because he's old. Well, let's look back just 4 years ago. How many young people voted for Bernie Sanders? That guy was ancient.
Millennials love to make like wacky cultural icons of like older people. Kristen, tweeting as Kay Chatwin, said, I just heard Steve Chaggaris call you liberal. You going to let him get away with that? I assume that you meant like
lowercase L.
Just you just meant that I was open-minded, permissive,
yes.
Which you know me to be, very permissive.
Yes, it was not a political statement about whether you think Happy New Year is good for the month.
Let's see. some other okay. Radu Marinesco says, think expiration date for Happy New Year is January 20th.
20th?
That's random. Why? I don't know why. Okay. Katie Herc says, I think it's okay to say Happy New Year to anyone you are seeing for the first time since New Year through most of January. Yeah. And the Biffy B says, my most recent online dating icebreaker is Happy New Year. Is it too late to still say that? I'm hoping to get distance out of this until at least February before reverting to, are you ready for spring yet?
Ah.
Yeah, well, February, you got to go low because it's Valentine's Day and you don't want, you know, there's like a whiff of desperate in the air. But I had suggested Biffy ask any interesting resolutions, right? Because it sounds kind of dirty, but it's not.
It's not at all.
Yeah, which is like sort of carrying over Happy New Year, takes it to a new place, Shaggy.
So any interesting resolutions?
Yeah, no, I talked about this the other day. Listeners, they were calling in with predictions and resolutions, and mine is to do more of it.
Whatever it is.
Yes.
Yeah.
Just do more of it. Yeah. Yeah.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
No.
Whatever you decide it is, you don't have to decide on January 1st what it is going to be. Just do more of it.
Do more of it. It came from this philosophizing auto mechanic I had in Houston named Bob, who, when I asked him what he would do differently, he laughed and said he would just do more of it. And it really resonated with me. It's been decades, but it really resonated. Let's see. Judith Cooper says, why don't we ever hear you imitate Trump? Because it's simple. I don't have a good Trump impression. I do some men impressions of some
such
men.
As
Boehner.
Oh,
where are the jobs? and I've and I can do W, but that's more of like an in-person thing. It was like you get with the shoulders and the six shooters.
Can I tell you a W joke that I can sort of do?
Yeah.
So when I met him prior to one of these, you know, rubber chicken dinners, I was with my wife, who was then my fiance, and I introduced her to the president, and he said, you getting married to this guy? And she said, yeah, we're getting married next year. He goes, still have time to change your mind. He was so proud of that joke.
that's very Bushy. That's very W. And then he probably told you that you were marrying up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. And yeah, that's very funny. Okay. Let's see some more comments from Twitter here. Is Kamala Caramel or Carmel?
Oh.
That's a debate we had on the show recently, because I say Carmel.
You say Carmel.
And others say Caramel.
I say Caramel.
You do say Caramel.
But a lot of people from the Bay State say Kamal.
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 Kamal. Oh, right. The Bay State. Yeah, Kamal. Kamal. Ask Shaggy how any Dem wins the daily news cycle if the president is indicted.
Oh, well.
That's such a hypothetical. Indicted by whom? Indicted in Congress or indicted by a grand jury?
But at that point, I think a little bit of pressure might be off the Democrats, because they're really only going to be, at that point, it depends when the president's indicted, right? If he's indicted during the Democratic primary process, well, Democrats are still going to be focused on what Democratic candidates are saying. And actually, the pressure is going to be off, because they're not going to be the focus.
Right. People aren't going to be demanding, why won't you investigate? Why won't you? Yeah.
Yeah. I just, you know, I think there's a lot less pressure to be the story every single day when there's another story that's ready made for cable. That would be, I think, an indictment would be that.
Shaggy, the president of the United States will be addressing the nation tomorrow at 9 p.m. East. A
mm-hmm.
Lot of debate about should the networks even show it, cover it, give them airtime. Of course, cable will, because they have to fill time.
Yeah, it's a good question, but I think you could ask that question about any president ever asking for prime time.
Right. Tell us, what are the considerations that go into that? Because it's a money thing, right? It's a financial decision in part.
Well, yeah, you're blowing out prime time, which is very, very lucrative for the big three now, or the big four networks. If you take out 9 to 10, whatever, I don't know what's on the networks at 9 to 10 these days, but they make a lot of money for the networks, and it's not rerun season. This is not, I saw a promo the other day for NCIS's first new episode of the year. So this Ooh. Is like, you're blowing out first run programming, and losing money. They don't run ads during the president's speech. And so, there's a big financial incentive, but there's also the public interest. I mean, think about it. These networks own television stations, and the television stations they own get licensed by the government, and part of that is to operate in the public interest. And so they have to weigh that against how much money they lose. And I think when the president and this president hasn't asked for a lot of time, so to I think reject it outright for political reasons would not be a good look on the network's
right,
part.
Right. How best to program it?
What do you mean?
I mean, so here on the POTUS channel, we're going to air it live. Excuse me. And then Olivier Knox and I will be doing some analysis and having guests, including Democrats and people with border knowledge and things like that, and doing some fact checking, some analysis, maybe a little rebuttal kind of thing. And to my thinking, that's the best you can do.
I think that's a lovely way to do it. I think that's the most informative way to do it. I think what the networks wind up doing is, because they want to get back to their primetime lineup, is that once the president's done, they'll do 5 minutes to get to the bottom of the hour, top of the hour or whatever, and then get right back into programming. And, it gets the president's message out there, but I don't think it informs people who are watching fully. I think most people who are interested will flip somewhere else, hopefully to SiriusXM Radio and the POTUS channel, but they'll flip somewhere else to get that context of what the president was talking about.
Right. I mean, Olivier was making the point earlier that that there's covering him and then there's broadcasting him, right? And there has to be some, given the bottomless Pinocchios, right? You can't just always blast it out.
But even if it wasn't the bottomless Pinocchios, I think, for any president, it would be, it's always useful to explain to people what the heck was just said over the last 45 minutes, right? This is the president, there's a reason why the president is going out there and asking for the largest audience possible to hear this statement of whatever they want to say, whether it's Donald Trump or Barack Obama, you name the president. And so I think it's only helpful to the viewer and to voters and to Americans to say, this is why the president is saying what he's saying. This is what it could mean, and put it all in the context. It's not just because the president is a four Pinocchio guy. It's because it's the president of the United States, and he is giving information from his point of view that I think needs to be broken down for the average person.
Absolutely. Listener Independent Clarity said, here's a good one for you and Shaggy. Does anything stop Obama from running again? He will wipe the floor with all, including Trump. Sanity. Sanity prevents Obama from running again.
But the Constitution, right, would prevent him.
Is it contiguous terms? Because didn't someone come back and run again?
I think it was two. I think it's two terms plus 2 years if you fill in for the a dead president.
Yeah.
Or a resigned president.
Yeah. So there's that. But I think Obama is living his best life. I mean, so what? He's got Grammys. He's nominated for he's making me mad. And he's talking about politics again, saying we need new blood. We can talk about that. And I want to talk about, I have to take a break, but then we're going to talk about Obama and we're going to talk about that Gallup polling about independence, that's about. All right. Mm-hmm. My guest is Steve Chaggaris. Stay with us. I'm Julie Mason. You're in the Press Pool on POTUS. I'm Julie Mason in studio with Steve Chaggaris. He's a noted blogger.
Noted. By you and I.
It's campaign2020focus.com. You can find him on Twitter at Steve Chaggaris. Okay, Walking Hippo, tweeting as Hippo Walking Wonders. With the superdelegates taking the back seat this go-round, what will the impact of moving the California primary up to those with less name recognition, i.e. cash flow, is that still putting a thumb on the scale?
Yeah, I mean, the money thing is going to be a really interesting thing to watch. Mainly, Elizabeth Warren is trying to set the parameters by being out there early and saying, we shouldn't take PAC money, we should leave the big donors out of this. And oh, by the way, the billionaires who are thinking of running, get out of here.
We don't want Bloomberg,
we don't want the self-funders in here. And she wants it to be all small donations. It's easy for her to say because she's very good at attracting small donations.
Yeah.
And there are a handful of
people. Self-funders have a right to run. Yeah.
Well, sure, everybody has a right to run.
Right.
But she's trying to change the parameters. Now, what's interesting is a couple of things. One, is self-funding going to be enough to get folks through a primary like California? I mean, California, think about it. You've got San Diego, San Francisco, and LA, three huge media markets, not to mention Sacramento, which is a pretty decent-sized market as well. That's very expensive just for television advertising.
Right. Mm-hmm.
To blanket the state and to run in that state is going to be hugely expensive. So it's not just small donors. You got to wonder if the people who are saying, I just want small donations, are hamstringing themselves early.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if they move up to March, I think it's March 3rd, California has an interesting twist in that they have early voting for their primary. So early voting starts 30 days prior, which would coincide with the Iowa caucuses. And so you'd have people campaigning in California at the same time as they are campaigning in Iowa.
Very, very droll troll move by the DNC to require anyone who runs in their primary to be a Democrat.
Yeah, well, that's geared right toward Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
But the superdelegates were mentioned as well. And this is going to be also interesting to watch. So the Democrats are going to award their delegates proportionally based on the results of primaries and caucuses. And if there are, 10, 12 candidates, there's a pretty good chance that nobody's going to get a majority of delegates going into the convention. So what does that mean? You get a brokered convention, but the change of the rules gives the superdelegates a little bit more power on the second ballot. And so maybe all they're doing is delaying the inevitable, which is the power of the superdelegates for the second ballot, not for the first ballot. It still makes it a little bit more of an open primary system, but if this gets down to a situation of a brokered convention, the superdelegates come back into play on that next ballot, and all bets are off.
Those states doing away with caucuses, unfortunate for those of us who love the caucusing.
You love the caucusing?
Yeah.
I find it hard. Here's the thing about the caucusing. I just find it as somebody who's waiting for results and trying to explain to people what caucuses are. It's just it's easier for me as an analyst and as a reporter to report on primaries just because it's sort of, here are the number of votes, here's the results. Caucuses are very, but if you're really into the political process, caucuses are a fascinating thing just because people are so involved.
Well, it's so organic.
It's organic.
It's like town meeting back home, right?
Yeah.
All right, Shaggy, talk to me about this this Gallup poll about the independence.
Yeah, so it's interesting. So they asked people, are you a Republican, Democrat, or independent? And more and more people are saying independent. I think it was above 40% this time around. But to me, the most interesting part of this poll was when they followed up and asked the independents, which way do you lean? And overall, it was 47% Democrat, 41% Republican, which you think, wow, the Democrats have a pretty big lead among Americans in terms of who they support. And historically, at least over the last 25 years, that's generally been the case. There's only been three times when that number has been more beneficial to the Republicans or close, where mm-hmm. it's basically been tied. 1991, when George H.W. Bush was in the Gulf War, 2002 after 9/11, and 2011.
Wow.
Yeah, right. So when people were sort of souring on President Obama. Uh-huh. Those are the three times that the Republicans, those numbers were much closer. So Democrats always have an advantage here. So, you know, it's interesting. They have an advantage, yet they're still not in the majority in the Senate, yet they still have, you know, a little bit of trouble getting a president elected. It's mm-hmm. just a fascinating thing to look at. But going into 2020, that's going to be an issue that that Trump and Republicans are going to have to look at very closely, that people are now hewing back again toward Democrats.
My guest, Steve Chaggaris, is a veteran political reporter, where you can find him on Twitter at Steve Chaggaris. Wow. Ben tweeting me a picture of Stalin making the heart fingers. I think that's doctored. I don't think Stalin.
You think that's?
I don't think Stalin ever.
You think that's photoshopped?
Yeah. No. I love that. I love that commercial, the Taco Bell commercial with the girl saying like "Sunset finger hands, take the picture, sunset finger hands" to her Instagram boyfriend.
Right.
Yeah. A fave here in the press pool. Let's see. Independent Clarity says I'll have to check later, but I think Quincy Adams was president twice. He was president for like a minute and a half. No, but the rules have changed since then, though, right? Because because FDR was president, like, for, what, 150 years?
Well, and you can be president in non-consecutive terms. I think the total is two full terms or 10 years.
Right.
Didn't say anything about consecutive.
Right. You could do, like, 2 years.
Look, if people really want Obama to go back and do this, you can just do what the Clintons did and have his wife run.
She will never run. She will never. She hates us. She'll never run. She hates all of us, including all voters, the whole process, the system, politicians, journalists. Phil Yabbitt wondering, is it Shaggy or Chaggy?
Ooh, that's actually a really good question. Some mm-hmm. people prefer spelling Shaggy, C-H-A-G-G-Y, which is my last name is spelled with a C-H,
uh-huh.
but still pronounce it Shaggy.
Shaggy.
But some people just go with the S-H just because that sort of makes a little more sense when you say it.
Yeah. Hmm. Shaggy, what do you make of this government shutdown that we're, what, now in week three?
Government shutdown? I haven't noticed it, except it took me less time to drive over here today.
I got into Le Diplomat on a Friday night. Right?
Amazing. I was out on a Friday night and there was nobody out.
It's everything's quiet.
Sort of.
I might be able to even get into Maydan. I'm going to have to look into that.
Wow.
I know.
Good luck before they reopen it in a couple of weeks. Right?
I think it's going to be. Did they close it?
No, reopen the government.
Oh, the government. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. No government employees are eating out at expensive places because they can't afford it.
Right. Or even coming into D.C. because they have no reason to be here.
Right.
It's interesting. So, you know, you're just seeing all this conflicting information. Like there was a Wall Street Journal report this afternoon that said that the president had told his aides, let's figure out a way out of this. Yet he's now going to the border on Thursday. He's giving this speech to the nation tomorrow. I just wonder if, you know, what is the way out?
There are both sides in a corner.
Right. So the Democrats either have to give something up, or maybe Republicans in the Senate are going to say, look, you know, this has gone on too long. Or the president just says, look, I'll just take less money, but I still need money for border security and or the wall. And, you know, I'll be happy. There was one train of thought that suggests that the president is sort of setting up a way to get out of this by giving the speech and then by going to the border and saying, look, I've tried everything. And these people aren't giving up, but people aren't going to be getting paid beginning on Friday. So we've got to open the government back up. Let's just go. And we'll see. Nobody really knows. But at the end of the day, it always comes down to with these things, when does it start? When do people start feeling it?
I think people are feeling it.
They're starting to feel it now. It was interesting. There was a poll that came out over the holidays that nobody really saw. It was an Economist YouGov poll. 8 in 10 Americans said they didn't know anybody, nor were they affected by the shutdown. But that was January 1st, mm-hmm. around that. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's a week later, and now you're starting to, people are starting to realize, okay, the trash is getting picked up at the national parks, and, oh, we might not get our tax return on time, or we work for the government and our paychecks aren't coming through, or TSA is calling out sick.
Oh, I saw a guy on MSNBC crying this morning in Colorado because his kid wanted a snack, and they don't have any money.
Yeah. So, I mean, as that grows, the pressure becomes much more intense on politicians to figure this out. And I think you're starting to see it growing. And I think Trump's going to really start to feel that, if not now, by the end of the week. And
yeah, it's been interesting to watch Mitch McConnell in all of this, right? Because he seems to have been somewhat, I don't want to say sidelined, or maybe he put himself on the sideline. Here's a little of, Mick Mulvaney. He was on NBC News talking about his various titles. He had an exchange with Jake Tapper about, that's about Afghanistan, that's irrelevant. But here's a little bit of what Lindsey Graham had to say.
Today. Dick Durbin is a good guy. He's a reasonable guy. But Nancy Pelosi has made progress. She's gone from not a penny to a dollar. Nancy Pelosi sees the border crisis as manufactured. President Trump sees it as real. Until we see the same movie, you're never going to reach a conclusion. The president is right to dig in to get money for a wall as part of border security. It will not be a concrete wall. It will be steel barriers. And every plan I've supported in the past with Dick Durbin has had money for physical barriers, mm-hmm. including walls and fences, except now when Trump's president.
The steel barrier gambit didn't pan out.
The semantics, though, it's just I love the people who are basically saying, "Why?" But he promised a concrete wall. Do you think Trump supporters care as long as there's some sort of barrier on the border? I don't think they care if it's concrete or steel. I think people just want to see the border shut, right?
That seems to be the overarching idea.
Many left turns that apparently illegal immigrants take. Did you hear that speech?
I didn't understand that. They come in and turn left?
Yeah, because they ride along the border, and then when they see the fences stop, then they take a left to come in.
Oh. You
know, they start in San Diego, and they work their way east, and then they take a left. Sort of like Bugs Bunny needed to take the left at Albuquerque.
Oh, man. Oh, hey, Shaggy, thank you so much for coming in.
Are we out of time?
Yeah, I know. Look at that. Half an hour. That's quick.
Wow.
I know.
So much fun.
I know. And we have so much more to talk about, but you'll come back soon?
Absolutely.
Okay. Steve Chaggaris is a veteran political reporter. You can find him on Twitter at Steve Chaggaris and check out his political blog. He'll be updating it, quarterly?
More than that.
Okay. It's called campaign2020focus.com for all his terrific analysis online. I'm Julie Mason. I got to take a break, but I'll be back. Stay with me. You're listening to The Press Pool on POTUS.